Hello, I'm Paul Manoguerra. I'm Director and Curator of the Jundt Art Museum here at Gonzaga University. I want to welcome you to our virtual tour of our exhibition this semester, which is titled A Grand Tour, Images of Italy from the Permanent Collection of the Jundt Art Museum. The exhibition intentionally functions as a visual travelogue of the Italian peninsula, using works of art entirely from the collection here at Gonzaga University in the Jundt Art Museum. The display opens with 16th, 17th, and 18th century European prints that are completely byproducts of artists' visits to the urban centers of Italy, such as Rome and Florence, and then the exhibition concludes with 21st century images. So we use the images in our collection to tell the story of what is commonly referred to as the Grand Tour. The Grand Tour begins really in the 16th century, and it focuses on European aristocrats as part of their classical education, taking a trip, usually around the European continent, but certainly one that ends in Italy, with really Rome as the ultimate goal. That trip then is rooted in the classical education that these European aristocrats were receiving. Artists, meanwhile, are a subset of those various grand tourists over the centuries. Artists themselves took a grand tour as part of their artistic education to learn to be professionals. And so this exhibition functions moving from the 16th century. The earliest work is from 1575. Through contemporary works, telling the story of how artists participated in this tradition of the Grand Tour, of visiting the Italian peninsula. The second theme then that runs through this exhibition is using the museum's collection, 76 works of art, 16th century to the contemporary. It takes us then, the exhibition, on a visual tour of the Italian peninsula. We get to move through the peninsula, we get to move through Italy vicariously through the works of art presented by the various artists in this exhibition. So the exhibition begins by taking us to Rome. We spend quite a bit of time in Rome in the early part of the exhibition. Then we get to spend a little bit of time in Florence with two images. Then we go to Tivoli for two images, the hill town just outside the city of Rome. And then we spend quite a bit of time in Venice, in particular Venice at the end of the 19th and into the early 20th century. Then we go back to Florence, and we spend time in Florence at the end of the 19th and into the 20th century. Then we get to enjoy two paintings in the exhibition that are themed on the Roman Campagna, on the countryside outside the walls of the city of Rome, two wonderful American paintings. And then we get to enjoy a painting of Assisi by an American Impressionist painter. Then we get to go to Southern Italy, and we visit Sicily, Naples, the Amalfi Coast. An image of Vesuvius is part of that section on Sicily and Southern Italy. Then lastly is an entire section that I just simply call Modern and Contemporary Artists in Italy. That's artists visiting the Italian peninsula after World War II, after 1945. And that section really hops us around Italy. We get to see Naples, we get to go to Palermo, we're in Rome, we're in Florence, we're in Siena for a couple images. So that section of the exhibition takes us around Italy. And so moving through the 76 works of art, again, all belonging to the Jundt Art Museum here at Gonzaga University, we get to live and visit Italy through the eyes of the artists as we move through those centuries. Etienne Duperac, painter and engraver, was one of several foreigners in 16th century Rome learning and participating in the printmaking trade. Originally from Paris or Bordeaux, he trained as an artisan and, through close observation of the ruins of the city, became a well-known antiquarian and mapmaker in Rome between 1559 and 1578. First published in 1575, his Vestiges of the Antiquities of Rome featured 35 views of the ancient sites, and the prints were published together in multiple editions. Duperac returned to France in 1578 and became a garden designer, architect, and painter for French noble and royal families until his death in 1604. This engraving, Remains of the Pantheon,
shows de Perec as a brilliant early engraver and important antiquarian. Meanwhile, remains of the Theater of Marcellus, showing the site near the Capitoline Hill in Rome, this one printed posthumously in 1606, reflects de Perec's continuing importance as a creator of images of ancient architecture within Baroque-era Rome. Rome functioned as an important center of printing in Europe during the end of the 16th century. By the 17th century, the center of Papal Rome was filled with print shops selling hundreds of single-sheet engravings, including maps, plans of the city, and images of the architecture, both ancient and contemporary. Using engraved copper plates and a wooden hand-operated machine, printmakers in Rome created a market in city images. The Bolker collection at the Jundt Art Museum includes a number of scenes featuring historic and contemporary sites popular with grand tourists in Rome. St. Peter's, Castel Sant'Angelo, the Arch of Constantine, the Column of Marcus Aurelius, St. John Lateran, Villa Borghese, and more. These prints, created by an international array of European artists, present Rome during the Age of Enlightenment, an era when the city served as a major international center for writers, historians, antiquarians, and philosophers. People like Edmund Burke, Jacques-Louis David, John Flaxman, Fragonard, Fuseli, Goethe, Edward Gibbon, Mengs, Sir Joshua Reynolds, Hubert Robert, Benjamin West, and many more. The Vedute prints visually documented the full range of architecture, from ancient to neoclassical, that interested Enlightenment-era grand tourists. They largely functioned as souvenirs.
An Italian printmaker named Giovanni Battista Piranesi was one of the more popular and influential printmakers in 18th century Rome. Piranesi had been born in Venice in 1720. He was part of a family tradition of working engineers, architects, and stonecutters. Traveled to Rome as a young man, was apprenticed to a specialist who was making etchings of Rome. And by 1743, Piranesi was creating his own independent prints. By the late 1740s, those prints were extremely popular throughout Europe, in particular with grand tourists visiting the city of Rome in the 18th century. One of the more well-known prints that were part of a series of 135 etchings that he did, called The Views of Rome, is this print, which is a view of the interior of the mausoleum of St. Costanza, dated to right about 1750. He likely worked on this print in 1749, 1750, and he shows us the interior of the mausoleum of St. Costanza, who was the Emperor Constantine's, likely his Emperor Constantine's daughter. Piranesi provides a central viewpoint of the interior of the mausoleum, which was also then turned into a church, and we have right at the center of the print the altar to the church. So you can see it there. Piranesi emphasizes the balance, the order, the symmetry of Santa Costanza. He gives us a glimpse of the rotunda with its dome, and then shows the surrounding barrel vaulted gallery with its 4th century geometric and nature-inspired mosaics, so ancient mosaics. But then what's wonderful about this print is he gives us walking around Santa Costanza, including this wonderful, probably honeymooning couple, he shows us 18th century grand tourists, tourists visiting the site. And as you move through the foreground of the print, you get to also see some of the tourists looking at Santa Costanza while you're looking at them, looking at the print. So it's a wonderful work right from about 1750 and an important work in the collection here at the Jundt Art Museum. Revisiting the idea of the Grand Tour, the strict definition of the Grand Tour usually refers to British aristocrats, Englishmen of the 18th century, who went across the channel to the continent as part of this concept of finishing their classical education. So this classical education was rooted in Latin, and it involved then also the study of the great writers of history, the thinkers and philosophers who also often wrote in Latin. Part of that then was also the study of the ancient writers, the ancient Roman writers, people like Cicero, Horace, Tacitus, Suetonius, that then also led to an understanding of something like the history of the Roman Empire. And so for these young British aristocrats going across the channel to the European continent, this travel was the end of that classical education, that education that they had been getting since they were children. That idea then of the Grand Tour in the 18th century really focused on a British phenomenon, but by the time you get to the 19th century, it expands to a much wider swath of people. So instead of just British gentlemen studying to be diplomats or merchants or lawyers serving the British Empire, it opens up to a much wider swath of people, including a middle class. And then eventually, when you're in the 19th century, the 1800s, also a middle class in the United States. And so the Grand Tour has an expanding definition as you move through time and begins to include more people taking this trip to Italy. The Grand Tour then also develops a literature, a set of canonical sites. So a proper Grand Tour usually included a trip to Paris, and then to Venice, Florence, Rome, and Naples. But the ultimate goal was always Rome. And then depending on who you were and what you wanted to see, you added other capitals in Europe to your tour. But Rome was always the goal. And it built up then a travel literature. So there were writers who wrote about their trips to Italy. And we have some of those books on display in the exhibition as well. But the other part of it is that there developed an industry around tourism in Italy. And one of those elements of the industry was the publication of tour guides, travel books that visitors taking a grand tour took with them so that they could know what to see and how to see it and to learn about the sites and the places that they were visiting. And we have some of those books on display. In the 19th century, in the middle part of the 1800s, the book, if you were a British or an American tourist to Rome, to Italy, that you took with you was Murray's Handbook. It was published by John Murray in London. And we have a couple of Murray's Handbooks on display and open in the exhibition here. By the end of the 19th century, it was Baedeker. Baedeker was published in Germany. And that was the go-to travel guide. By the early part of the 20th century, it was a Michelin guide, because cars and traveling Europe by car, you've got the tire company Michelin then creating a travel book to teach you about what to see and how to see it as you traveled around Italy. By the time I was an undergraduate studying abroad in the late 1980s, it was a book published specifically for study abroad students, which was called Let's Go. And so you went everywhere with a Let's Go Italy to tell you where the hostels were and the inexpensive restaurants, and then also the sites and the places that you needed to visit whenever you were in a particular town in Italy. So you took Let's Go Italy with you. These days, it's probably the internet. You go to the internet to learn about what you want to see and how to see it, to make reservations for your hotel. You can do that right from your phone these days. But that industry, that travel industry, as well as the travel literature, are some of the objects that we also have on display in the exhibition. With that in mind, we also created an exhibition book in which all 76 works that are on display in the exhibition are illustrated. There's a series of essays, and you notice it's the same size as a Michelin guide, the idea being that you can slip it into your jacket pocket and take it out here in the exhibition and read about one of the works of art that's on display. This wonderful work is by English printmaker William Hogarth. Hogarth was born in London. He was apprenticed as a teenager to a silverplate engraver. And by the 1720s, Hogarth was an accomplished painter and printmaker himself. He often did series of narrative engravings, often with satire that presented social issues, and they really endured as the things that he's the most famous for. In 1753, however, Hogarth published a book, a treatise, on aesthetics, education, and artistic practice called Analysis of Beauty. And it was rooted in that classical tradition, based in the ancient Greeks and the Romans and in the Renaissance. That was a byproduct of his own classical education. That book was directed at connoisseurs, directed at philosophers, fellow artists, many of whom had also been grand tourists. Analysis of Beauty serves as an attempt for him to organize, to document specific examples of artistic concepts like line, shape, ornament, and form. In this particular print, which served as a plate in the book Analysis of Beauty, he gives us a scene featuring a courtyard filled with copies of famous ancient sculptures, statuary, and then contemporary visitors admiring those ancient sculptures. So in that grouping, there is the Farnese Hercules, there is the Vatican Antinous, the Lawakawan is in there, Apollo Belvedere, the Medicean Venus, and so many others. I'll take you in a little bit closer and give you a chance, in particular, you can see the Lawakawan there. Wonderfully executed by Hogarth. Surrounding the edges of the courtyard imagery then, Hogarth places a series of drawings and sketches that reference observations of shape and line. So you've got flowers, clothing, furniture, decorative art, portrait busts, other sculptures. And then he numbers and labels the print. It corresponds to the text, Analysis of Beauty. And it referred both to the commodification of copies of ancient sculpture in 18th century England and the Italian collections in Italy itself that remained so important to his fellow Englishmen on the Grand Tour. At this point in the exhibition, we get our first two images of Florence. These are works from the 18th century, and Giuseppe Zocchi, like Piranesi in Rome, Zocchi was the go-to person for images, for prints of the city of Florence. And we have these two wonderful prints in the collection here at the Jundt Art Museum. The one up top by Giuseppe Zocchi shows the Ponte Santa Trinità on the Arno in Florence, where you also get the Ponte Vecchio in the background. And then just wonderful scenes of daily life existing there along the Arno in Florence. And then one which is essentially the same locale where we get a view looking down the bridge, the Ponte Santa Trinità, from the Piazza Santa Trinità and the churches and palazzos that are right there on the square itself. So we've got these two wonderful images of Florence in the mid part of the 18th century, which would have been the kind of images that grand tourists visiting Florence would have taken back to wherever they were from when they returned from their grand tour.
This print represents our first work by an American artist in the exhibition. George Loring Brown's The Falls of Tivoli exemplifies the American picturesque image of the tourist site. Born in Boston in 1814, the artist left for his second trip to Italy in 1840 and remained there for about two decades. During the 1850s in Rome, Brown had a studio, which writer Nathaniel Hawthorne visited in 1858. And was part of the American artist community that included Worthington Whitridge, Thomas Crawford, and Randolph Rogers. American tourists often directly commissioned Brown's paintings of Italian scenes as grand tour souvenirs. Between 1847 and 1855, Brown painted numerous views of Tivoli. In this etching view, rooted in the observations and views of his painted versions, he includes the craggy cliffs, steep waterfalls, and primeval vegetation of the summer landscape in the area. The verticality of the etching stresses the steep nature of the various cascades. Brown emphasizes the picturesqueness of the three long waterfalls as they each cascade into a rocky pool and its moss-covered rocks before merging into a single fall at the foreground center of the print. At the upper right of his etching, Brown shows the round temple of Tivoli atop the rocky cliff. This is John Aloysius Stanton's Venice Harbor Scene from 1896, a wonderful oil on canvas painting. Capturing Venice as viewed from its lagoon, Stanton depicts the open water of the harbor in the foreground. He then presents the array of boats, including the double-masted Bragozze fishing boats in the right middle ground. In the distance, beyond the colorful sails of the boats, the dome of Santa Maria della Salute and the bell tower of St. Mark's appear in the rosy shades of the atmosphere at sunset. A painter, designer, and printmaker, Stanton was born in Grass Valley, California, and grew up in San Francisco on his parents' ranch in the Mission District. After graduating from St. Ignatius High School, Stanton studied at the Mark Hopkins School of Design and later spent several years in Paris. In 1904, Stanton moved to Palo Alto and began producing etchings and monotypes using a press he purchased from the Palo Alto Times. And today, Stanton's images are in the collections of the Harvard Art Museums, the Fine Arts Museums of San Francisco, and the Chazin Museum of Art at the University of Wisconsin. Here, Stanton's painting of Venice functions as a very typical example of popular American scenes of the Venetian lagoon, the canals, and the boats of the city during the late 19th and early 20th centuries.
One of the more well-known artists in this exhibition is American-born James Abbott McNeill Whistler. Whistler really has two famous paintings that most people have probably heard of, especially one of the paintings. That's one that's commonly referred to as Whistler's Mother. It is a painting largely painted in black and grays of the artist's mother, elderly woman, seated in a chair, shown in profile. The proper title for that is Arrangement in Black and Gray, colon, the artist's mother. Many of Whistler's titles reference musical terms. He'd like to think about his paintings and the experience of his paintings in terms of the relationship between art and music, so that a painting and its colors struck a particular tone, an emotional chord in the viewer. And so many of his paintings have titles like Arrangement or Symphony or Etude or Nocturne in their titles, with that idea of corresponding the emotional impact of music and the emotional impact of experiencing one of his paintings. His other most famous painting is a story that's then related to our print that's on display here. That is one that is commonly referred to as Falling Rocket. It is a nocturne. It was painted by Whistler in the 1870s, and it shows abstracted a fireworks display along the Thames in London in the Chelsea neighborhood. And it was a painting that Whistler put on display at the National Exhibition in England, where it was viewed by England's most famous art critic, a man who had been writing about art for four decades at that point, John Ruskin. And John Ruskin criticized Whistler's painting, did so in print. He said that Whistler was flinging a pot of paint in the public's face. Whistler took exception, as you can imagine, and sued Ruskin for libel. And it is one of the more famous libel cases, legal cases of libel in the history of law. Whistler versus Ruskin. Whistler, the basic end of the story is Whistler wins the libel suit, but wins such a small financial payment from the suit that he can't even pay his legal bills. So Whistler has to declare bankruptcy. He sells his English house. He had amassed a large collection of, wonderful collection of English porcelain that he had to sell at auction just to pay his legal fees. Art print then comes into the story at that point. Whistler is bankrupt and he gets hired by the Fine Arts Society in London to go to Venice to create a series of etchings on behalf of the Fine Arts Society in London, which they will sell. But then Whistler can also use the images that he creates for his own purposes. So Whistler does that, bankrupt, goes on commission to Venice on part of the Fine Arts Society to create a whole series of etchings of the city of Venice. Etchings then are based on the work of using a copper plate, treating it with an acid-resistant material, then using tools to carve a design into the copper plate and marking away that acid-resistant material. You then drop the copper plate into an acid bath. Those markings then bite on the plate. You take the plate, you ink it up, use a press, piece of paper, you pull the piece of paper away, and you have the image that is a copper etching. Our copper etching then in this exhibition by Whistler dates to 1880, and it's a byproduct of that whole story of his libel suit against Ruskin and being bankrupt and going to Venice on the commission of the Fine Arts Society. It's a work called San Giorgio, which shows the lagoon in Venice with all of these boats and their wonderful vertical masts, but then also the skyline of Venice, including the church that the title comes from, which is San Giorgio Maggiore, which is most famous as a Renaissance era Palladian church. And we get that up here in the upper left-hand corner. What's wonderful about Whistler's etchings is that really there's not that much information being conveyed by the markings. It's a wonderful example of what we would talk about in art appreciation class as negative space. So much of the image itself is just the paper and the color of the paper being used to convey, for example, the water of the lagoon or the sky of Venice. Now, what's remarkable about Whistler is that he was such a well-known artist that he spurs in his interest in creating copper etchings an entire etching revival that takes place at the end of the 19th and into the 20th century, where you have a number of artists who simply wanted to be like Whistler. And they went to Venice, just like Whistler did, to create their own copper etchings of scenes of the city. And so we have a whole section of the exhibition then building upon our Whistler with a whole series of images that are in our collection created by British and American artists of Venice using copper etchings because they simply wanted to be like Whistler.
American printmakers in the late 19th and early 20th centuries spent significant amounts of time studying and creating art in Florence and Tuscany. Many American literary figures and artists of the time visited Florence as part of a grand tour of Italy and reflected on the Italian past. American artists lived, worked, and filled their sketchbooks while abroad, then fashioned prints, paintings, and sculptures resulting from their encounters with Florence, its masterpieces, and the life and landscape of central Italy. Some American artists developed a style reflective of the neoclassicism and realism of the Renaissance, inspired by the art of Florence. By the 1880s, Rome was no longer the primary pilgrimage site for young artists, overshadowed by the more poetic Venice or by the more cosmopolitan and modern Paris. Yet Americans continue to visit Florence as a place to experience lyrical Gothic and Renaissance architecture and art popular with Victorians. Largely under the influence of English aesthete, historian, and critic John Ruskin, of American writer and diplomat William Dean Howells, and of American painter Henry Roderick Newman, artists made many images of the architecture of Florence, often using sketches executed out of doors. Popular sites with artists, of course, included the Ponte Vecchio and the other bridges along the Arno in Florence. Other artists focused on Brunelleschi's dome for the Duomo. Still others found inspiration in the Tuscan countryside, with its hilltop towns, olive groves, and rustic structures. This exquisite painting, titled Italy from 1917, was painted by American Douglas Arthur Teed. Teed here builds upon the tradition of making dreamlike pictures of the great stretches of the plain of the Roman Campagna outside the walls of the city. Influenced as a painter by the French Barbizon artists, popular themselves in Boston and New York in the last half of the 19th century, and by American landscape painter George Innes, Teed himself was born in New Hartford, New York, near Utica. Growing up during the Civil War and its aftermath, Teed was surrounded by his own father's discussions of spirituality. These ideas of spirituality were often reflected in Teed's paintings, sometimes mystical, often mysterious. The upper three-fourths of Italy features the sky over the landscape outside the walls of the city of Rome. Muddy browns and greens dominate the bottom fourth of the image. Teed's feathery brushstrokes of green and brown create a sense of pine needles and canopy from the umbrella stone pines. The artist places a lone figure with a tall staff or walking stick in the right middle ground of Italy. On the same linear plane as the solitary figure, Teed provides the only sense of the city of Rome through the silhouette of Michelangelo's dome for St. Peter's, painted in gray. The setting sun emerges as the true protagonist of the painting's narrative of time, history, and loss. This oil on canvas painting by American Dwight Benton is titled Rome and dates to right about 1900. Born in Norwich, New York, Benton, also greatly influenced by the Hudson River School of American painters and by tonalist painters like George Innes, was active as a painter himself in Cincinnati from the mid-1860s until 1876 when he left for Italy. Lillian Whiting's book, Italy, The Magic Land from 1907, includes a section on the non-Catholic cemetery, the so-called Protestant cemetery in Rome, famous in the 19th century as the burial site of Romantic poets John Keats and Percy Shelley. In that section of her book, she includes some commentary on Dwight Benton. Quote, an American painter and writer who was for some time in the diplomatic service and whose home had been in Rome for more than a quarter of a century lies buried here. For many years, he was the editor of the Roman World, which still sustains the interesting character that marked it during his editorship, unquote. Whiting also notes that King Victor Emmanuel III purchased one of Benton's paintings. Rome, our painting seen here, may depict the gated entrance to the non-Catholic cemetery or another site near the walls of the city of Rome. In the immediate foreground, a dirt pathway amid overgrown plants leads to a stone and metal gateway in a brown wall. In the partially open green entryway, a clergyman, dressed in black, emerges. Beyond and above the gate in the wall, Benton paints a number of stone pines receding into the distance and toward a Roman building.
Our one image in the exhibition of Assisi is this wonderful painting by John Ferguson Weir. John Ferguson Weir was an American Impressionist. So as an artist who was using Impressionist techniques drawn out of the French Impressionist movement, people like Claude Monet, Edgar Degas, Renoir, Pizarro, and using those techniques. And what American Impressionists typically did was apply them to an American landscape. Those loose brush strokes, the bright keyed color, those Easter egg sorts of colors, the pastels, then applied to the American landscape. But in this case, though, John Ferguson Weir is visiting Assisi in 1902 and uses those French Impressionist techniques and applies them to the Basilica of St. Francis in this wonderful scene in the central Italian hill town. John Ferguson Weir had a history of painting in the United States that was rooted also in his training at West Point. His father was a longtime professor of architectural drawing at West Point, and Weir learned from his father. Rather than going into the military, he decided that he wanted to be an artist, and did so really for 4 or 5 decades, creating paintings. Weir is also famous for being the founder of the art school at Yale University, and he was its longtime, first-time director there at Yale. But in 1902, he's visiting Italy with his wife and his mother-in-law, and they're spending time in that particular summer in Rome. And in Rome, if you've ever been to Rome in the summer, it's hot, it's crowded, it's a little dirty, even in 1902. And they decide to escape the heat and the commotion of Rome and go to central Italy and to visit Assisi. And they end up spending quite a bit of time in Assisi, where they have this wonderful view outside of their hotel window. And in doing so, Weir creates from his hotel window this panorama that shows the Basilica of St. Francis in Assisi. And of course, Assisi is the home of the medieval saint, St. Francis. He is buried in this church to the present day. And his concepts of imitation of Jesus, of brotherly love, of communing with nature, that spirituality of St. Francis is often talked about being exuded in the experience of the city itself. And so we get some of that in that wonderful sunset scene here that Weir gives us, with the wonderful pink and rosy hues as they cast that fading light onto the Basilica of St. Francis in this painting.
American Joseph Pennell, as part of his 3 decades living outside the United States, made a 1913 trip from London to what he called the Land of Temples, Sicily and Greece. Pennell's wife, in describing his time in Sicily, notes, "At Taormina, he waited days for the mists to clear, and when at last they did, I had it all to myself, for it was tea time," Pennell said. Etna over Taormina results from that late afternoon clearing view of the ruins, the Sicilian coast, and the distant volcano. In his etching, Pennell creates a dark silhouette of the ruins of the amphitheater at Taormina in the foreground against the light of the late afternoon sky. Heavy with black ink, the foreground of the print provides some shaded sense of a few figures among the broken columns and the curve of the amphitheater's seating. Open, barrel-vaulted archways lead to the expanse of the top two-thirds of the vertical print, featuring cliffs and hillside towns at the right, and coastline of the Mediterranean at the left. The ink of the print provides a sense of the misty atmosphere, accentuated by the volcano Mount Etna in the distant background. The smoke from a volcanic eruption billows and drifts, intermingling with Pennell's presentation of clouds and the Sicilian sky.
I'm not really allowed to have favorites in an exhibition where I'm the curator, but there's probably a top tier of works that I'm particularly proud that the Jundt Art Museum owns, and this work is one of them. Our artist is American artist Red Grooms. Red Grooms, born in Nashville, Tennessee, and he is a 20th century example of the quintessential multimedia artist. He worked in painting, he worked in sculpture, he worked in drawing, some of those traditional materials, but he also was a performance artist. He did conceptual art. He worked in video. He did collages. Some of his most famous works are installations, entire room installations, where he combines all of those techniques into the experience of a work of art that he's created. And it's in 1968 where Red Grooms becomes the American artist representative to the every other year exhibition in Venice, known as the Venice Biennial. It is an international exhibition of artists, and he becomes the American representative to the Venice Biennial in 1968, where he creates a work of art themed on the city of Chicago with its skyscrapers and actually St. Patrick's Day, Green River, and some of the other aspects, the slaughterhouses, some of those other details that typically get associated with the city of Chicago. He creates that in Venice as his entry to the Venice Biennial as the American artist. But of course, while he's in Italy in 1968, he decides to travel. And he gets all the way down to Sicily in 1968, which is where our work of art comes from. This is a drawing, a sketch, an ink sketch by Red Grooms created in Palermo in 1968. And you can see it has been cut by Grooms right out of his sketchbook and then framed up and on display for you here, where he gives us this wonderful scene of the open air market in Palermo. With all of the characters, you can actually imagine all of the smells and the noise that come with this open air market in Palermo, where you have fish, including, I love some of these wonderful fish here in the basket, including this one that's got a nice bug eye looking back at us here. You get dogs, you get fruit vendors, you get political broadsides, and then you get a whole array of these various characters that make up people visiting the open air market in Palermo, including these wonderful cartoonish satirical heads of all of these children that he experienced while he was doing this sketch in Palermo in 1968. So like James Abbott McNeil Whistler, the other artist that most people visiting this exhibition, even if they don't have a deep understanding of art history, the other name that they've probably heard is the artist of this work, who is Andy Warhol. This is a work from late in Warhol's career. Warhol dies in 1987. This is a work created in 1985. And in the mid-1980s, he was invited to Naples by a contemporary art dealer. Warhol goes to Naples and creates images themed on the Bay of Naples for display, paintings, prints, both large and small, for this contemporary art display for sale in Naples in 1985. And our print is a byproduct of that experience of Warhol visiting Naples in 1985. Its subject matter, of course, is Mount Vesuvius. Mount Vesuvius has two famous eruptions. One is in 79 AD in the ancient Roman world, where the eruption of Vesuvius buries places like Pompeii and Herculaneum in pumice and ash. The other is in 1944 during the Allied invasion of Italy during World War II, in particular the Allied amphibious landing at Anzio. At that point, Vesuvius decides to erupt as well in 1944. When Warhol is visiting Naples in 1985, Vesuvius isn't erupting. But he decides he wants that drama of a volcanic eruption for some of the images that he's creating for sale. And so what he does is he uses, like he often does, borrowing from other elements of culture, he uses a postcard showing a previous eruption of Vesuvius and repurposes that in particular for our lithograph that we have on display here. And it would have been something that he would have done in a series where for different images he would have used different bold pop colors that emerge from the image. Ours is this wonderful red and black in particular. And our work here at the Jundt Art Museum has the title Vesuvius number 14. So it gives you this idea that he is working in series and dealing with the same image over a period of time. So it's wonderful that we've got this image by Warhol in the collection here at the Jundt Art Museum. So the earliest work in the exhibition, 16th century, dates to 1575, of the Pantheon in Rome. We end the exhibition with two works that are dated to 2015, so relatively contemporary works of art. And we finally get an image at the end of the exhibition of the Colosseum in Rome. So we start with the Pantheon in Rome, we end with the Colosseum in Rome. This is a work by American artist Joe Essing. He's a Brooklyn-based artist, New York, who spends his time, his every day, working in art therapy in New York City in Brooklyn. But he visits in 2015 on a family trip, a family vacation, he visits Rome. And he decides he wants to create an image of the Colosseum. But in my conversations with Joe, he's told me that he felt burdened by all of the images, all of the history related to the Colosseum. And he wanted to create an image, but he didn't really know how to go about it, what aspect of it. So many of the images, of course, show us it, the Colosseum, in a monumental way. Other images, of course, are, especially these days, are selfies, where people are taking pictures of themselves with the Colosseum in the background to show that they're there, but then to also show the building itself behind them. What he elects to do is to take a section of the Colosseum, which isn't one of the more pretty aspects of the Colosseum. The Colosseum, of course, is a ruin. And for centuries, the marble in the Colosseum was repurposed for the various churches and monuments created by the Renaissance and Baroque popes throughout the city. It essentially served as a giant marble quarry for people building other elements in the city of Rome. And so most of the marble, a lot of the marble of the Colosseum has been stripped away over time. The other aspect is it's not a full oval at this particular section. Often you get to see the part where it still seems relatively complete. Here Joe decides to show us the section where it is in ruins, where that marble has been stripped away down to the brick in particular, but also the section where the oval is incomplete, where it is in fact a ruin, and you see the different layers of the different ambulatory walkways that are part of the Colosseum functioning as a stadium. So we get the wonderful dark areas of these barrel vaults. But then of course in the foreground, like in the Piranesi print from Santa Costanza in the 18th century, we get tourists. In particular, we essentially get a self-portrait of Joe and his family here in the center foreground, as Joe in particular with his arms behind his head and his small children look up at the ruins of the Colosseum. So it's wonderful to have this print of the Colosseum in the exhibition, but also to have a contemporary work that deals with tourism as part of this exhibition called A Grand Tour.